We want to determine any relative extrema using the first derivative test. So the first step is to determine the possible locations of relative max and mins. And these occur at the critical numbers, which is where the first derivative would be equal to 0 or where the derivative is undefined. So we'll start by determining the derivative of the given function. F prime of x is going to be equal to 12x squared minus 30x minus 18. And the derivative of 12 would be 0. So this derivative function is never undefined, so now we want to determine where it's equal to 0. So we'll set it equal to 0 and solve. We have a quadratic equation, so let's see if we can factor this. The greatest common factor of these three terms would be 6, leaving us with 2x squared minus 5x minus 3. So it looks like this will factor. The first positions of the binomial factors must come from the factors of 2x squared. That would be 2x and x. And the second positions must come from the factors of negative 3, so that the inner product and outer product has a sum of negative 5x. So if we put minus 3 here and plus 1 here, notice how we have negative 6x plus 1x, and that does give us negative 5x. So the derivative is equal to 0 when 2x plus 1 equals 0, or when x minus 3 is equal to 0. So solving for x, we would subtract 1 and divide by 2. We have x equals negative 1 half here, and we have x equals 3 here. And these two x values are the critical numbers, which are the possible locations for any relative extrema. So now what we're going to do is take the domain of the given function, which is all real numbers, and divide it up into intervals using these critical numbers. So what I mean by that is if we have a number line that represents all real numbers, and then we plot negative 1 half, and then we plot 3, notice how we have three intervals. The interval on the left, in the middle, and on the right. And then we're going to test the sign of the first derivative in each interval, which will tell us whether the function is increasing or decreasing in that interval. And then from there, we can determine if we have any relative max or mins. So I think it's often best to organize this information in a table. And I've already done that to save some time. Notice the first interval is from negative infinity to negative 1 half. And then we have from negative 1 half to 3, and then from 3 to infinity. So we're going to pick a test value in each interval. And then using the test value, we'll determine the sign of the first derivative. And then from there, we can draw our conclusions and then determine if we have any relative extrema. So let's start by determining a possible test value. We need some number that would be in this interval. For example, negative 1. In this interval, we could select 0. And here we could select 4. Now we'll sub these x values into the first derivative, which I've copied here from the previous screen. It doesn't matter whether we use the factored form or the expanded form of the first derivative. I'm going to go ahead and use the factored form. So f prime of negative 1 would be 6 times 2 times negative 1 plus 1, that's going to be negative 1, times negative 1 minus 3, that's negative 4. And this is going to be equal to 24, which is positive. So the sign of the first derivative is positive in this entire interval. And now we'll determine f prime of 0 for the middle interval. So we'll have 6 times 2 times 0 plus 1 is 1, and 0 minus 3 is negative 3. So this is negative 18, which is negative. And then for the last interval, we'll test the value of x equals 4. So we have 6 times 2 times 4 plus 1, that's 9. And here we have 4 minus 3, that's 1. So we have 6 times 9, which is equal to 54, which is positive. Now the signs of the derivative tell us whether the function is increasing or decreasing on that interval. So on this interval, since the derivative is positive, the function is increasing. On this interval, the first derivative is negative, so it's decreasing. And then it's positive again, so the function is increasing on this interval. So that tells us the function. So to visualize this, the function is increasing on this interval, decreasing on this middle interval, and then increasing again on this last interval. So at x equals negative 1 half, we have a high point. or a relative maximum. And at x equals 3, we have a low point or a relative minimum. So let's go ahead and record this down here. We have a relative maximum at x equals negative 1 half, and we have a relative minimum at x equals 3. So we know the locations, but we actually haven't determined the relative max and min values yet, and those are the function values of the original function. So we'll determine f of negative 1 half to determine the relative maximum, and then we'll determine f of 3 to determine the relative minimum. To do that, we'll go ahead and use the calculator. So I've already typed the original function into y1. And now we're going to go back to the home screen. We're going to press vars, right arrow, enter, enter to select y1. And then we can just type in negative 1 half in a set of parentheses. So the relative maximum is 16.75, or 16 and 3/4. So then we'll press vars, right arrow, enter, enter. And then we'll enter 3 in a set of parentheses. So our relative minimum is equal to negative 69. So it's important to remember that the relative max and min values are function values, and the critical numbers are the locations. So we had a max of 16.75 and a min of negative 69. Now I do want to mention that sometimes you'll see textbooks list the relative extrema as ordered pairs, which is okay. This would be the point negative 1 half, 16.75 as the relative max, and this would be the point 3, negative 69 for the relative minimum. But I think it's important to remember that the function value is actually the relative max or min, and the x value is a location. And let's go ahead and verify this graphically. Here's the relative max we found, and here's the relative min that we found. This was negative 1 half, 16 and 3/4, and this was 3, negative 69. I hope you found this helpful.